Modern offshoots of Christianity, and we've heard about some of them tonight. In fact, we heard about several of them from one person. So imagine having gone through trying to deal with Mormonism and the children of God and all the rest of it, you know, and not sure what to believe. That's like an advertisement for organizations like Paul Cardin's CIFAR and for Institute for Religious Research. Modern offshoots of Christianity disagree wildly among themselves about many things. And you can see here some of the things that you hear from various groups. I wonder how many of these groups you might recognize from their some of their cries. No blood transfusions, no birthdays. Anybody know who that is? Jehovah's Witnesses, yeah. Speak in tongues, no cutting women's hair. Yeah, that's right, United Pentecostal Church, or Oneness Pentecostal denomination. Read the Book of Mormon, baptized for the dead. That's too easy. It's pretty obvious. Anyway, you've probably seen or heard many of these. So they all have their different thing, don't they? They say, this proves we are the end times religion or the true form of Christianity because we're the only one saying this. Well, you pretty much usually are the only one saying these strange things, but that doesn't mean that you're the true religion. However, a common theme among all these groups is criticism of the Orthodox historic Christian doctrine of the Trinity. All these gentlemen are wearing no Trinity t-shirts. I don't know if you can tell that from where you're sitting there. Thomas Jefferson, who is an admirable figure in many respects and maybe not in some others, was very much opposed to the Trinity. As an example of deists in their opposition to the Trinity, he said, ideas must be distinct before reason can act upon them, and no man ever had a distinct idea of the Trinity. It is mere abracadabra of the mountebanks calling themselves the priests of Jesus. Andrews Norton, a Unitarian author, had a similar view. And he specifically denied that it was a Christian doctrine. The Trinity is not a doctrine of Christ and his apostles, but a fiction of the school of the later Platonists. James White, I think you've all heard of him. This isn't the guy with Alpha and Omega Ministries, by the way. That's a different James White. This is the James White who was a co-founder of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I think, actually, you heard this quote earlier in the day, in another presentation, the way spiritualizers have disposed of or denied the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ is first using the old unscriptural Trinitarian creed. That's what James White said, among other things. Mary Baker Eddy, the founder of the Church of Christ Scientist, more popularly known as Christian Science. Walter Martin used to say Christian Science is like grape nuts. It's neither grape nor nuts, and Christian Science is neither Christian nor science. So I got my Walter Martin quote in there. She said, the theory of three persons in one God, that is a personal trinity or triunity, suggests polytheism rather than the one ever-present I am. The Watchtower Society, in a booklet entitled, Should You Believe in the Trinity?, comments, the Trinity doctrine, their concept of God himself, is borrowed from pagan sources and was developed in its present form centuries after Bible writing was completed, end quote. Joseph Smith, in another famous sermon, preached just a few weeks after the one that Paul Cardin quoted earlier. This is what's commonly known as the Sermon at the Grove. Just a few weeks before his death, Joseph Smith, the founder of Mormonism, said, quote, many men say that there is one God. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost are one God. I say that's a strange God anyhow. All are to be crammed into one God, according to sectarianism. It would make the biggest God in all the world. He would be a wonderfully big God. He would be a giant or a monster, end quote. There's a tolerant assessment for you. Witness Lee, the founder of a group of churches known as the local churches, or often just called the local church movement, Witness Lee said, quote, the traditional explanation of the Trinity is grossly inadequate and borders on tritheism. That's the belief in three gods. To split the Godhead into these separate persons is not the revelation of the Bible, but the doctrine of the Nicene Creed, end quote. Obviously, there is no downside in our culture to knocking the Nicene Creed. You know, you knock the Nicene Creed, an awful lot of people don't have a problem with that. Here's David K. Bernard. At the time, he was an up-and-coming Oneness Pentecostal author and theologian in the United Pentecostal Church. He then became the superintendent, general superintendent of the entire denomination. Bernard wrote in his book, The Oneness of God, "The doctrine of the Trinity is non-biblical, both in terminology and in historical origin. It has its roots in polytheism, pagan religion, and pagan philosophy." Now, while these groups all agree that the Trinity is wrong, they differ wildly on what is right. Unitarians maintain that the Father alone is God and that Jesus was just a man whom God exalted after his resurrection. This is similar to an ancient heresy known as adoptionism, which basically says Jesus was adopted as a divine son after his death and resurrection, or perhaps earlier, such as at his baptism. There are variations on these themes, as you can imagine. Some early Adventists, and not just in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, but in other groups as well, and in the Jehovah's Witnesses, which really is an Adventist sect as well, they have argued that Jesus was a lesser god, often identified as Michael the Archangel, which is the Jehovah's Witness position to this day. This view is similar to the ancient heresy known as Arianism. This is not A-R-Y, but A-R-I-A-N-I-S-M, following in the teachings of the 4th century heretic Arius. But although I should mention that Arius was not a Jehovah's Witness, the Jehovah's Witnesses would disown him and disfellowship him in a heartbeat for the things that he believed and didn't believe compared to their own religion. Mormonism claims that the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and they prefer Holy Ghost to Holy Spirit in reference to the third person, that they are three gods. Sometimes to mollify Christians, they will say they are one Godhead. But Godhead in Mormonese means a committee or triumvirate of three separate gods, not one divine being. Jesus is the first of God's spirit children. Heavenly Father and Heavenly Mother in Mormonism have billions, trillions probably, of spirit children, including all of us. We were all their spirit children in heaven, and our eldest brother is Jesus. He's just the first one of our family, of our brothers and sisters, to make it to godhood, and you can too. First thing to do is join the Mormon religion. Oneness Pentecostals maintain that the Father is God, and that the Son is God's manifestation of himself in the flesh. So there's really only one divine person, God, who manifests himself in different ways, rather than three distinct persons that are co-eternal. This is similar to the ancient heresy known as Monarchianism. Monarchianism itself has different forms. and another one of those is represented, at least in some of what Witness Lee taught about the Trinity. In the local churches, Witness Lee taught that the Father became the Son, and then the Son became the Holy Spirit. And it gets wilder than that. In some sense, Witness Lee taught that the Holy Spirit then became the church. So, but of course, you got to be in the right church, otherwise it's no good. Now, this is similar to what's often called modalism, which is an ancient heresy that basically said that the Father became the Son, etc. Local church people don't like that comparison, but at least some of what Witness Lee taught clearly made those claims. Now, what does the doctrine of the Trinity affirm? What is it really saying? We need to have a handle on that before we can really make any progress or headway in discussing the doctrine and the trouble that people have with the doctrine of the Trinity. So here is a list of basic affirmations that are essential to the doctrine of the Trinity. I'll just go through these very quickly. One God created and rules the world. This one God is one being. There's, in some sense, he's an indivisible entity. The Father is God. The Son, who became the man Jesus Christ, is God. The Holy Spirit is God. The Father is not the Son, the Son is not the Holy Spirit, and the Father is not the Holy Spirit. Now, I want you to notice something here. All of these propositions that I've presented to you as the essential affirmations of the doctrine of the Trinity don't use any extra biblical terminology. I don't have to use the word Trinity to affirm it. The word Trinity is just a convenient theological shorthand for what I just said, all of which comes right out of the Bible. Now, this statement I'm going to make may be a little difficult, so I will unpack it. All non-Trinitarian theologies that profess to be Christian, so all the ones that we've been talking about, they all agree with the Trinity on some points. Not the same points as each other, but they all agree with the Trinity on some points. And every essential point that we've just looked at of Trinitarian theology is affirmed by at least some non-Trinitarians. There's nothing that I've just said there in that previous slide that are the essential affirmations of the doctrine of the Trinity that you won't find some anti-Trinitarians agreeing with. So really, we're not asking anybody to agree with something that none of them agree with. They all agree with some of them. In fact, all of these points are assented to by one or another anti-Trinitarian group. So here's a little table that gives you the breakdown of how this works. to me, this is the way my mind works. I'm sorry. I just have to kind of lay it all out so I can see it and go, ah, yes, indeed. Because I had this sneaking suspicion years ago that this was the case. So I thought, I'm going to test my hypothesis and see if it holds up. And in fact, it does. Every single one of these affirmations, there is one God, God is one being, etc., they are all affirmed by one or more of the anti-Trinitarian groups. It's just they can't agree on each among themselves as to which ones of these are right and which ones are wrong. I'd love to get, you know, one representative of each of these groups in a room together sometime and just let them fight it out, you know. Because what they do is they constantly attack the doctrine of the Trinity, but they rarely talk about each other. Jehovah's Witnesses, they have, once in a blue moon, they'll talk about the Mormons and vice versa. Even that's even rarer. They generally don't talk about each other's anti-Trinitarian heresies. They spend most of their time attacking the Nicene Creed, Orthodox Christianity, because that's where most people are. Now let's talk very briefly about the biblical foundations of the doctrine of the Trinity. It's my position that the Trinity is not an extra-biblical truth, but it is a doctrinal formulation based on the Bible. But what does that mean? As you well know, religious groups often claim to be based on the Bible, but then they go off into theological la-la land. Why is that? How does that happen? Well, I just want to mention three very simple premises or foundational guiding principles for Christians in approaching the Bible theologically or doctrinally. The first is that the Bible is the only written word of God and the final authority from God for Christian doctrine. So if you've got if you say you believe in the Bible as the word of God, but you also have something else, like the Book of Mormon, or Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures by Mary Baker Eddy, or whatever it might be. And those are indispensable guides to understanding the Bible correctly, or whatever theological language that your religion uses to put it as it's the Bible plus this, what this prophet wrote, what this organization published, or whatever it is, then we've got a problem. Second, the New Testament builds on and interprets the Old Testament, not the other way around. Now, the first thing I said probably was not surprising, and you probably heard it a thousand times. This one, I think many people miss this. What goes wrong with the way anti-Trinitarians typically read the Bible? Typically what they do is they do this. Well, I'm reading the Old Testament, I don't see a Trinity there. Therefore, there can't be one in the New Testament. So I'm going to take anything I find in the New Testament that doesn't seem to fit what I already believe from the reading the Old Testament, and I'm going to shoehorn that into what I've already decided is acceptable. So now we're really interpreting the New Testament in light of the Old, as if the Old Testament is the definitive revelation and the New Testament has to be shoehorned into it. But of course, historically, that's not the way it worked or works. The Old Testament is God preparing the way for the definitive revelation of himself in Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit's coming in the church. Given to us in narrative and expositional doctrinal explanation in the New Testament. So if you want to understand the Old Testament correctly, you need to understand it in light of the New Testament. That doesn't mean we shoehorn the Old Testament into the New. What it means is we recognize that God revealed himself progressively, historically, through the history of Israel to the coming of Jesus Christ and the founding of the church. As a community of Jews and Gentiles who had come to know Jesus Christ as God incarnate. So it's very important hermeneutically, that's a 50-cent theological term for how you interpret Scripture, it's very important to get this right. And I constantly run into this with anti-Trinitarian groups, that they want to turn it upside down and say, well, if you can't show it from the Old Testament, it's no good. You know, as if that definitively closes the door on the New Testament revealing anything more about God than what we already know in the Old Testament. Finally, on this point of biblical foundations, we learn from the early church's reading of the Bible without treating the early church as authoritative. We don't ignore it, but we also don't elevate it to a position of authority so that it's the Bible plus the early church. You know, it's no better than any of the other things. But we don't ignore the early church, and for a very good reason. What do all these groups have in common? Well, they all claim to be latter-day restorations of true Christianity. If that's true, then there must have been some exemplar, some instance of that true Christianity in the first century, and hopefully, you know, a little bit of it surviving into the second century before it got squashed like a bug by Constantine or something. Is historical nonsense, but you get my point. So if there were Jehovah's Witnesses in the first century and into the second century, we should find some if we look in church history. We don't. If there were Oneness Pentecostals, we should find some. We don't. If there were Mormons, we should find some. We don't. All right, so we learn from the early church's reading of the Bible, and we pay attention to how Christianity developed. Without treating the early church or its creeds as extra-biblical authorities through which we impose meaning on the Bible. Now I'm going to talk about some fundamental things that we need to know about to understand the Trinity, and I've tried to arrange these in a convenient and perhaps memorable way, I don't know, with the numbers 1 through 5. Yes, I know. I happen to think this is, I might actually be able to remember this, so, you know. First, there is one monotheistic creator God. Then we're going to talk about the fact that there are two natures in the incarnate Son, his divine nature and human nature. We will talk about the three divine persons that we see in Christian confession throughout the New Testament. We will talk about four parallels between Jesus and the Holy Spirit that show the Holy Spirit to be a divine person. And then we will look at five questions that people commonly ask about the Trinity. All right, you all buckled in there, okay. Please do not disable smoke detectors in the lavatories and so forth and so on. All right, so one monotheistic creator God. Now what do I mean when I say there is one God? I do not mean there is only one being in the Bible that ever gets the appellation or word God applied to him or it. That isn't necessarily the case. It all depends on context. Words can have different meanings in different contexts. No, what we mean is this. Biblical monotheism is the is the doctrine that existence is divided into two categories: the world, which is created, and God, who is its creator and ruler. In other words, there's God, the ruler, sovereign, creator, Lord, king of all else that exists. There's God and everything else. That's monotheism. That's the Bible. That's Bible 101. Now, this is amply taught in both the Old and New Testaments, and I've given up here a string of references from Genesis to Revelation to illustrate that this is something that you find throughout the Bible. I wish I had time to go through all of these texts, but you're probably familiar with several of them, even maybe the references just by looking at them. You know what some of these are. Obviously, Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, this monotheistic creator God is called Yahweh or Jehovah in the Old Testament. In English Bibles, commonly the Lord. And he is identified as this one God, using the Hebrew word Elohim. And this identification is made in a number of ways, approximately 1,000 times. That's a conservative number in the Old Testament. By the way, it's always a good idea in trying to develop a biblical doctrine, a biblical theology, to base what you're saying on as much of the Bible as possible, not just an isolated verse here or there. Anti-Trinitarians are notorious for camping on one verse and saying, this is it, this proves everything. We don't need any other verse in the Bible. We've got John 17:3. You know, I love John 17:3, but it's not the whole Bible. Biblical monotheism eliminates certain claims that non-Trinitarians commonly make. And these differ from one theology to the next, but you find several of these popping up. Several of these theologies will buy into one or more of these premises or assumptions. That God the Father is an embodied being, and in fact that all persons must be embodied beings. I'm surprised at how many of these anti-Trinitarian groups buy into this. Mormonism notoriously does, but so do Jehovah's Witnesses, and from what I can tell, so does Adventism. It's an amazing phenomenon, the assumption that if you're going to be a personal being, you must have a body. That is not biblical. Angels don't have bodies. They can appear in bodily form, but they don't have bodies as part of their spiritual nature. God is a transcendent, infinite spirit. He does not have a body. That's not part of what it means to be God. Body is a spatial phenomenon. To have a body, you must be a being that occupies a certain amount of space. But God made space. Where was that body before he made space? See, theologians and philosophers, we worry about these things. Biblical monotheism eliminates the notion that making or ruling all of creation was something that God could delegate to one or more subordinates. Again, this is a common theme in many anti-Trinitarian theologies. Jehovah's Witnesses say that Jehovah God the Father drew up the blueprints for the universe and then told his created son, Michael the Archangel, "You go build it." What, me? I've never made a universe before, Dad. As if making a universe is something that God could, you know, delegate to an angel. Mormonism goes even further than this. According to Mormonism, in one of their scriptures, the Book of Abraham, says that a number of worthy intelligences, which are eternal beings that coexisted with God back in eons ago, that they got together and organized the earth. And later, Mormon leaders, presidents and prophets of the Mormon church said that they believed that Abraham was himself one of those, and Joseph Smith was one of those beings, worthies, that helped to make the world. Making a world is a lot harder than these people seem to think. Also, the notion that human spirits are potential gods of the same nature as God the Father, that's ruled out. Because to be God, in this sense, of the monotheistic kind of God, is by definition to have always been God. If you're not God already, there's no hope for you. You're never going to make it. Because to be God means to always be God. So that's just one job that will forever be above your pay grade. Sorry. The position has been filled. Nothing you can do. Richard Bauckham, New Testament scholar who was for many years at the University of St. Andrews, said, quote, however diverse Judaism may have been in other respects, this was common. Only the God of Israel is worthy of worship because he is sole creator of all things and ruler of all things, end quote. Now, once you understand that, a lot of the New Testament becomes a real problem if you don't like the doctrine of the Trinity. Second, there are two natures in the incarnate Son. That Jesus is God, he has divine nature, and he is a man, he has human nature. The Bible says both of these things explicitly. It calls him God in John 1:1. The Word was God, and he was God in the beginning. He didn't become a God, he just was God. John 20:28, after his resurrection, Thomas acknowledged Jesus to be his Lord and his God. We could look at other references where we see the same thing. Paul, John, Peter, all of the major biblical authors in one way or another affirm that Jesus is God. The Bible, of course, also affirms that Jesus is a man. I usually don't have to prove that to people today, but I just throw that in there. The Bible is quite clear. Jesus is a fully human being. Fully human. As God, Jesus existed before the creation of the world. In the beginning, the Word was. He was already there. John 17:5, Jesus says he's going to return to the glory that he had with the Father before the world was. Colossians 1:17, Paul says that the Son existed before all things. Of course, Jesus was also born. He had a beginning of his human life. That's what it means to be born. As God, Jesus has absolute, universal, sovereign, unending authority over all things, in heaven and on earth. When I was first talking with Jehovah's Witnesses many years ago, I was only 17, believe it or not, we had weekly meetings, this Jehovah's Witness couple and we would talk about what the Bible said about various subjects, mostly about the Trinity and the deity of Christ. And I remember the last reference that we really talked about was Matthew 28:18. And I said, Jesus says in Matthew 28:18 that he has all authority in heaven and on earth. That's everywhere. Nothing seems to be excluded. Ephesians 1, he has the name that is above every name. His authority, his power, his glory. It's above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. Sorry, Muhammad. Okay, there's no, Jesus was great for his time, but we've got an even better prophet today. No, you can't top Jesus. At the same time Jesus is God, we see in the New Testament, and this is something that Jehovah's Witnesses, for example, will get real excited about, that Jesus submits to the Father and even calls the Father his God. And he even does it after his resurrection. Now here I find even some Christians are a little bit confused. Because a Jehovah's Witness says, well, I know you can say when Jesus was on the earth and he was a man that he had to submit to the Father as his God, but he's resurrected and he's in heaven now. Why does he have to do it now? Folks, Jesus is still a man. Acts 17:31, cited up there in the first row there, Paul said that God was going to judge the world at the end of history through a man whom he has appointed, having furnished proof to all human beings by raising that man from the dead. Of course, that's Jesus. Jesus is human right now. Colossians 1:2-9 says, in him all the fullness of the divine nature dwells in bodily form right now. Paul writing that 25 years or so after the resurrection. So Jesus is a human being. And as a human being, he is the head of the new creation and he submits to the Father as to his God on our behalf. And that's a permanent situation. He's not ever going to stop being a man. He is the God-man. God the Son, the eternal second person of the Trinity, permanently united himself to our peon nature in order to save us. And he isn't giving it up. Wow, that's mercy. I mean, okay, you come down, you do what you have to do, and you go right back and say, boy, I'm glad that's over. No, it's never over. Jesus has become one of us. The Son of God became one of us to save us and to reconcile us to the Father. That's unbelievable grace. And you want to add something to that? You can't. Jesus was not a man who became exalted to godhood, as the Unitarians claim. He was God and became a man who was then exalted to his rightful place. So after Jesus humbled himself, Philippians 2, 6 to 8, God, the Father, God highly exalted him. And people say, well, he can't be God if he's being exalted, because if you're God, you're already there. You can't. No, he humbled himself to a position where he then basically said, Father, it's up to you now. You're going to have to bring me back and exalt me. And that's how salvation is going to be done. So God the Father highly exalted Jesus and gave him the name that's above every name, told everybody that this is him, this is God, this is the Lord. Worship him. And that does not detract from God's glory. In fact, Paul says, to the glory of God the Father. There's no competition for glory among the three persons. If I may speak anthropomorphically, if there's any competition, they all want to glorify each other. They all want to humble themselves to glorify one another. What I mean by that will become even more evident in a moment. Grant Osborne, another New Testament scholar, points out that some of us Christians don't have a full grasp or aren't paying attention to who Jesus really is. He warns Christians are guilty of the syndrome, your Jesus is too small. We have made Jesus our big brother and friend to such an extent that we have lost the sense that he is also our sovereign Lord. We must recapture the realization that he too is our God and worthy of worship at the deepest level. End quote. Third, there are three divine persons in Christian confession. Throughout the New Testament, we see this pattern. The Trinity is not a post-biblical construct that is being foisted on the text of the New Testament. It is a confession that we see arising from the New Testament almost at every turn. And in particular, these passages where we see the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit mentioned side by side are very often in the context of religious observance, worship, corporate fellowship, baptism, things like that. So, example, Matthew 28:19, Jesus told his apostles, the disciples, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So you see, when you get baptized, you're confessing, you're uniting yourself to, you're swearing allegiance to, you're committing yourself religiously to the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, this does not mean to Jehovah God, his right-hand lieutenant, created angel Michael, and a force. And that's just one of the less subtle perversions of this text that you will run into. Nor is he saying, baptizing them in the name of Heavenly Father, his firstborn spirit child, and we don't know who that Holy Ghost is. Might be an uncle or something. That's kind of what you get in Mormonism. They don't really know who the Holy Ghost is. 2 Corinthians 13:14, again, a religious context of a benediction at the end of the epistle. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. 1 Corinthians 12:4-6, emphasizing that spiritual gifts come from the Spirit, the Lord, and God. If we didn't know from elsewhere in Paul's writings, even in 1 Corinthians, that the Lord was Jesus, distinct from God the Father, you could see these as just three ways of saying the same thing. But in fact, we know this. There's a personal distinction being made here, or that's implicit here. Same language is found in Ephesians 4, 4 through 6. There is one body and one spirit. And Paul kind of interrupts the confession or hymn or whatever he's quoting here. Just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and Father of all, who is over all, through all, and in all. Again, very doxological kind of language, worship language. 1 Peter 1, 2. I've heard many people say, many anti-Trinitarians will say, well, if the Trinity is true, shouldn't the Holy Spirit be mentioned in the salutations? You know, those things that Paul opened his letter and he says, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. How come he doesn't mention the Holy Spirit? Well, Paul didn't do that, but Peter did. According to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ, and for sprinkling with his blood. There's all three persons mentioned in Peter's salutation. And then in Revelation 1, 4-5, I had to get a verse in Revelation in here. Okay, just had to do it. A very different salutation, but using very unusual language, but if you understand the way the book of Revelation is written, it's the Trinity. From him who is and who was and who is to come, from the seven spirits who are before his throne, which is a symbolic image of the Holy Spirit, and from Jesus Christ. And then John goes on to talk about what Jesus has done for us. Scott Harrell, a theologian at Dallas Theological Seminary, has reviewed over 100 of these kinds of statements throughout the New Testament, and his conclusion is the threefold experience of the personal God is densely woven throughout the New Testament. Next time someone says to you, the Trinity, that's just all based on like one or two verses like John 1:1, isn't it? No. It's found throughout the New Testament in various ways. All right, so now fourth, four parallels between Jesus and the Spirit. There's actually a lot more, but I'm going to pick out four really good ones that I think are very helpful in showing us that the Holy Spirit is a divine person like Jesus. We've already established Jesus as God. Now I'm going to show that the Holy Spirit is someone else very much like Jesus, the Son of God. So here's our four parallels, and they're A, B, C, and D. I'm making this too easy, aren't I? I mean, it looks easy. It's not, but... looks easy. A, for another advocate. I couldn't keep that up, but it's two ways there. Another advocate. Advocate here translates the Greek word parakletos, which is also translated comforter, helper, and other words are used in English, but it's a word that means a representative or agent who helps you get in touch with somebody who can help you. Basically connect you with the guy, with the person that's going to give you what you need, the judge or the king or whoever it might be, or in this case, God. John 14, verse 16, Jesus says that he's going to leave the disciples, but he's going to send them, the Father is going to send them another paraclete, another advocate. Why does he say another? Because he's the first one. Jesus has been their advocate. He is their advocate. He is their representative to get them in a relationship with God. In fact, Jesus has just said that in John 14, verse 6. But now he says, I'm going to go, but when I leave, the Father will send you another advocate, another parakletos, and that's the Holy Spirit. Actually, the Gospel of John doesn't ever explicitly refer to Jesus as the paraclete, but 1 John 2, verse 1 does, same Greek word. We have an advocate with the Father. B, by the way, obviously, I should do the little, QED here or draw the conclusion. If the Holy Spirit is another advocate, representative, agent between us and the Father, then he's someone, just like Jesus is someone. The Holy Spirit's not a force. Okay, the Holy Spirit is someone who comes from the Father to bring us into an effective and real relationship with the Father. B, believers receive and know the Holy Spirit, and unbelievers don't. And the Bible said, the Gospel of John says this also about Jesus, that believers receive him, but unbelievers don't. He came to his own wouldn't receive him. But those who did receive him, to them, God gave the right to be the children of God. John 1, 10 through 13. Many references that we could look at on most of these points, so I'm going through them rather quickly. C, the Holy Spirit, like Jesus, came down from heaven, sent by the Father. John 14:24 and 14:26, we see both side by side. Jesus came from the Father, and now he's going to go back, John 16:28, to the Father. The Holy Spirit will then come from the Father down to the disciples, just as Jesus had come down from the Father to them. So there's a similar kind of descent. It doesn't happen in the same way. The Holy Spirit doesn't become a man. He fills men and women. But he comes, and he's someone who comes from the Father and from Jesus, because both the Father and the Son are involved in sending the Holy Spirit. So that's C, and then D, the Holy Spirit does not speak on his own. Now, there's two things here I want to draw your attention to very quickly. The first is that he speaks, obviously. Now, many evangelical Christians know this, and they know that this is one of the proofs of the Holy Spirit being a person, but they don't see this in the context. What is the context here? And all these references you see are from the Gospel of John. That's not because I don't like the other books of the New Testament. It's because this is the first time in history that the people of God are told about the coming of this person that we know as the Holy Spirit. It's the first time. There are references to the Spirit, to the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament, other references in the Gospels prior to this time, but this is the first time that we have anyone giving a sustained teaching about the Holy Spirit. It's in John 14 to 16. It's at a crucial moment because Jesus is about to die, rise from the dead, and go to heaven, and then the Holy Spirit is going to come. And if I had time, and I don't, I would have another lengthy look at the book of Acts where we see him come. And he does exactly what Jesus said in John 14 to 16 the Holy Spirit would do. But notice that the Holy Spirit speaks. Why is this important? Because Jesus isn't around to speak anymore. Jesus is not physically present with the disciples anymore. So the picture here is the Father sent the Son. The Son came, he spoke, he acted, he leaves. Then he sends someone in his place from the Father, the Holy Spirit, who's another advocate, another agent of the Father. He also speaks. He speaks in a different way. He doesn't use a mouth. He uses other people's mouths. He uses people's mouths, disciples, apostles, prophets in the New Testament period. But he speaks. And so there's a narrative here. There's a story that is being given to us there in the Gospel of John of what's going to happen. The Holy Spirit's going to come, and he's going to do these things as the Father and the Son's representative. And that's the other thing that's noticeable here. He doesn't speak on his own. Now, that's a really strange thing to say about a force. And the electricity will not act on its own, but it will only do what you tell it to when you flip the switch. Is that what Jesus is saying here? I don't think so. He doesn't use that kind of impersonal language anyway. What he's saying is the same thing that he says about himself as the Son in John 5:19. The Son does not do anything on his own, but only what the Father, he sees the Father doing. And whatever the Father does, Jesus says in John 5:19, the Son also does in like manner. By the way, that's going to be a key reference in the talk I'm going to give tomorrow on the sinlessness of Jesus Christ. But notice here that the Holy Spirit does not speak on his own initiative. If I may put it to you, the Holy Spirit also humbles himself. We're very familiar with the concept as Christians of the Son of God humbling himself to become a man. I don't know if this has ever occurred to you, but it didn't occur to me for a long time, but I finally saw something that just shocked me. And as the Holy Spirit humbled himself too. How did the Holy Spirit come? He came in a really quiet way. He came and regenerated people's hearts. He came and gave human beings boldness to speak in the name of Christ. Yes, there was a little bit of smoke and mirrors on Pentecost Day, but then it was pretty much over. The Holy Spirit does not generally like to draw attention to himself. Now, on the day of Pentecost, you got to do something because it's the first time. And many people in church history, especially for the last two centuries or so, have looked at Acts 2 and said, "That we should have that today." Why? Are we starting over? In many cases, I think the answer is yes. They think they're starting over. The Holy Spirit comes in a very unassuming, inglorious fashion, if you really look at real work of the Holy Spirit. Now, of course, if you think the Holy Spirit is where you find the Holy Spirit, is at a Benny Hinn crusade or something like that, okay, that seems pretty exciting. But most of what the Holy Spirit does, you never see. And in fact, the New Testament uses language about the Holy Spirit's coming that many people say, that doesn't sound like a person. Why isn't there some really good, strong language about the Holy Spirit being God and everything? He's going to be poured out on people. That doesn't sound very, real. Well, why? Because he's coming in a way that we need him. And he, just like Jesus came in the way we needed him. We did not need Jesus to show up, with the legions of angels and conquer the Romans and set up the kingdom. We needed him to come as the humble carpenter from Nazareth to die on the cross for our sins. We also need the Holy Spirit to come in the way that he has come, as this quiet working in the heart of believers. He humbled himself to come for our salvation. Raymond Brown, deceased Roman Catholic New Testament scholar, author of a famous commentary on the Gospel of John, said, "As another paraclete, the paraclete, that is the Holy Spirit, is, as it were, another Jesus." And I think he's got it right. He's not Jesus in the same way. Of course, he isn't Jesus, but he's like Jesus. Yet, half of self-identified American evangelicals last year in a survey agreed that the Holy Spirit was a force. So if you think I'm just going to stand here and badmouth the sects and cults and, we've got it all figured out. No, we've got some teaching to do in our own churches. A lot of people are confused on this point. Finally, five questions frequently asked, and I'm going to run through these because I know I'm way over time. If Jesus is God, why didn't he just say so? Well, again, I've said that he humbled himself, so he was waiting for the Father to make it clear to people who he really was. Also, if Jesus come up to people and say, "Hi, I'm God," first of all, they would have locked him up or killed him before he had a chance to get anything done, and secondly, they probably would have misunderstood that he was claiming to be the Father. This is something that had to be found out over a period of time in which the truth becomes revealed. This kind of question, why doesn't the Bible say this? Why didn't Jesus say that? How come Paul didn't mention the Holy Spirit here? These are all called arguments from silence. They're bad arguments. We need to base our doctrine on what the Bible does say, rather than carping at the fact that it doesn't say what we would like it to say. Number two, did the Trinity derive from paganism? Well, if the essential elements of the doctrine are biblical, obviously not. Now, it's true, ancient cultures often believed in three gods, and four gods, and 400 gods, and, on and on. They often had three at the top. For some reason, that was just the number that they often settled on. But they were three gods ruling the rest of the gods. That's not the Trinity. it may be a reflection of the fact that in our hearts we kind of have some inkling of what's real out there, and we just don't really know how to express it. That's a possibility. By the way, this constant talking about the Trinity supposedly coming from paganism, this is not an ancient criticism of the doctrine of the Trinity. It's a modern one. Ancient heretics didn't complain about this. That wasn't the issue. Third, was the Trinity imposed by Constantine? Well, since it had been around, the doctrine of the Trinity had been around in the word Trinity and on the three persons and all that for more than a century before Nicaea, obviously Constantine did not invent the doctrine or make it something Christians had to believe for the first time. Now, he did convene the Council of Nicaea, and he did back the bishop's decision, but he didn't tell the bishops what to decide. That was up to them. And again, few, if any, critics of the Trinity today are Arians. They're not saying, our guy, he got stopped there. And they don't want Arius, rightly so. But there weren't any of these groups back then. I made that point earlier. And so it really is moot what happened in the fourth century. By the way, beware of getting your knowledge of church history from sources like Dan Brown's The Da Vinci Code, or more recently, Newsweek magazine. I did a lecture on this Newsweek article just last month, and I have to admit it was like shooting fish in a barrel because the article was really bad. Number four, must one believe in the Trinity to be saved? Well, not exactly. And I maintain that we are not saved by passing a theology exam. Some of you are breathing sighs of relief right now. However, disbelief in the Trinity is generally a symptom that something's wrong. Particularly if you hold to an anti-Trinitarian theology, there is evidence that something is wrong. You've been deceived. You don't really understand what you're doing when you pray. And all other kinds of things can be at fault there. But the point here is that the Trinity is simply a theological safeguard to make sure the church keeps teaching the truth about Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. So when people say, I don't think we should worship Jesus Christ, at least not the way we worship God the Father, red alert, okay? We got a problem. The Trinity tells us there's a problem. So it's a theological construct. Yes, the word Trinity isn't in the Bible. You don't have to believe that word is the best word, but if you're rejecting the doctrine of the Trinity for something that's not biblical, that's a symptom of something seriously wrong. Finally, number five, isn't the doctrine of the Trinity illogical? Well, not baldly at least, because the doctrine does not maintain that there's one God and three gods at the same time. It does not say that there is one person and three persons. Rather, the doctrine of the Trinity says there is one God in three persons. Now, admittedly, there's still some mystery here. However, other aspects of God's nature are equally puzzling. For example, that God knows everything, and yet he makes free choices. If you know what you're going to have for breakfast tomorrow, can you freely choose what to eat? I don't know. I don't know how that works. God knows everything he's ever going to do. Does he make free choices? Is he responsible for his choices? That's kind of a mind bender, isn't it? I don't know why people think everything about God is easy to understand in Christianity except the Trinity. That's not true. Everything about God is mind-bending if you think about it. And like I said, we theologians and philosophers, we worry about these things. But I say that facetiously to point out that the fact that you don't understand something that God has revealed about himself is not a reason to reject it. It's a reason to admit that you aren't as smart as you thought you were. Nature also presents us with some paradoxes. For example, that there was nothing before the beginning of the universe. Our minds just don't like that. Well, it had to be something. Or the universe, according to Stephen Hawking and other cosmologists, the universe is finite, but it has no edge. There's no wall of the universe, not even a receding wall. I don't even know, well, what is it? It's hard to understand. Light is both wave and particle. It's got to be one or the other. You can't be both. Well, light apparently is. And we could go on and on. If the natural world can have paradoxes like that, maybe God could be paradoxical. C.S. Lewis said, quote, "If Christianity was something we were making up, of course we could make it easier. But it is not. We cannot compete in simplicity with people who are inventing religions. How could we? We are dealing with fact, with a capital F. Of course, anyone can be simple if he has no facts to bother about." C.S. Lewis is eminently quotable, and so I'm going to stop there. We have a web address here. I have a wealth of articles on the Doctrine of the Trinity on our website at irr.org. There's some recommended books, and thank you very much for your attention.